Hello and welcome to this episode of Sleep Like a Boss. And I'm super excited to be here with you today. Today is going to be a pretty geeky episode for you. And we're going to talk about a peptide that has been discovered pretty recently in terms of science, 1998, and it's called Orexin or Hyprocretin, depending on where you look at your literature. Basically, it was discovered by two different groups at the same time and they gave it different names, but it is the same peptide. So I'm going to talk about this because there is a very strong relationship to its presence and to sleep. And there's also been quite a few developments in pharmacology with this peptide. So I want to explain it a little bit to you so that you're aware of what is out there. Also, if you come across it by taking any different or other medication, it's always good to know. So this is a little bit more of a scientific episode. Bear with me. All right. So what is interesting to know is that when the peptide Hyprocretin or Orexin was discovered, there was pretty quickly a link between its presence or rather its absence and narcolepsy. So what research has discovered is that the less peptides you have of Hyprocretin or the absence of it, the more you are likely to have narcolepsy. And they've actually discovered that patients with narcolepsy, as they age, start to reduce their number of Hyprocretin, and that in the end, they actually don't have any left. Now, this is really interesting because it could actually hint to the fact that narcolepsy is actually an autoimmune disease, as the body is basically sabotaging itself and it's, you know, disrupting its production of that peptide. Why that is the case hasn't been discovered yet. Super interesting. But I find it a super interesting theory, and it totally makes sense. So as it also makes sense that having not any of those peptides left, as that increases sleepiness or the onset of sleep, it's logical that actually when you have too much of it or when you have an overstimulation of it, it promotes wakefulness. So they have done some studies where they took sleeping animals and they've basically stimulated orexin or Hyprocretin in their brain. And it was shown that they would wake up both from slow wave sleep as well as from REM sleep a lot quicker. So it was going to disrupt their sleep, and it would be basically, and it didn't matter whether it was REM sleep or whether it was slow wave sleep. And it also really shortened the amount of time that they would actually wake up from it. So first of all, they would wake up at all, but also much more quickly than if it was naturally. What was interesting though, and that's the last point that I'm going to talk about, is that when given an antagonist to orexin at the same time, that effect would not happen, which means that for pharma, this is really interesting because they would basically see if someone has an issue with an overproduction of orexin or Hyprocretin, an antagonist will actually be able to help them not to wake up. So you can imagine it like having very fickle sleep, having super light sleep all the time. If you're someone who's waking up super, super quickly all the time, that maybe that could be the answer to your problem in a chemical package. Let's put it that way. So there is a new drug that has been introduced in 2015. It's called suvorexin, and it's actually an antagonist. It's a dual orexin antagonist, which means that if you take it at night, it makes sure that your Hyprocretin or your orexin is not waking you up. And it does not disrupt cognition, which a lot of other sleep drugs do. They will leave you groggy. They will leave you with brain fog the next day. This one apparently doesn't. Obviously, I've never tried it, so I can't vouch for it, but that's what the science is saying for now. The other thing why it was on my radar is that it's been promoted in terms of that it helps with drug abuse. So research has shown that people who have an addiction, whether it is a nicotine, a drug addiction, or alcohol, that they suffer a lot from sleep disruption, and that sleep disruption makes it even more difficult for them to recover from their addiction. Now, When treated with dual orexin antagonist, it has been shown that the genetic and behavioral changes that are caused by these drugs, addictive drugs such as amphetamine and nicotine, can be blocked. What is interesting to me is like, okay, have they been blocked because suddenly sleep is back, or have they blocked in correlation of the peptide? That is not quite as clear to me. So in general, I would argue that when you get your sleep back, your body is able to rebalance itself and to heal and to fight against anything that's unnatural. So that would be my case for that drug in this context. So for me, you know that I'm not a big fan of sleeping pills in general. You are not sleeping because you don't have enough sleeping pill in your body. So it doesn't make sense that that would be the answer. However, when I do have clients who are so stressed because they haven't been sleeping that they just can't do anything, like there's no point in doing another protocol because they cannot even think, then sometimes having a period of sleeping pills just to give your body a break, just to survive, is fine. Then I do find that this is a very interesting one because it does not disrupt your cognition. So have a look at it, talk about it with your MD if you are, you know, looking to get that break before you start looking into why you are not sleeping. What is the root cause? Why might you produce too much of that peptide? There is a reason. That's where I come in. That's where I go digging. But if you need something in the meantime, this might be something to look into. So I find it super interesting, makes sense. Also, if you are someone who has narcolepsy and nobody's talked to you about it, might be a good idea to look into. All right, so that was it for this week. A little bit more scientific. I still hope you liked it though. And I will talk to you again next week. So talk soon. Bye.